这样的人。从整个圣经来看，有的人是很伟大，像保罗就是很伟大的人。他的本质本来就很伟大，不过他一开始的时候，他是逼迫教会的人哈，逼迫教会的人，连这样的人，神也这样可以用。他只是因为他不懂，他不认识，他不知道，他就做了，其实是抵挡神的事情。可是他以为他这样做是，是做神喜悦的事情，所以他就绝对的去做他认为对的事情，直到他遇见了主，他整个人生就改变了。那耶稣在地上的时候，耶稣一直他在这个三年半的当中，他曾经对上万的人讲道，他曾经做很多医治的工作，还有赶鬼哈。但是其实耶稣那三年半最重要的事情，就是带这十二个门徒。那弟兄姐妹你知道门徒这个词在圣经里面是非常非常重要。你知道门徒是什么意思吗？什么叫门徒啊？跟随者，门徒跟学生有没有一样啊？门徒跟学生有没有一样？有一点点有类似，也有类似，也有也有一样，也有不一样哈，也有不一样。那今天我们在学校基本上我们就是做学生。那学生最重要就是学老师的知识啊。那老师怎样，他的品格怎样，其实他不是在教我们品格，他只是教我们知识。那我们想要从他身上学的就是学他的知识，他教我们一些的知识。那门徒有很大不一样。耶稣在大使命里面，就是耶稣要升天呢，他告诉门徒说，你们要往普天下去传福音给万民听。那福音传出去以后就有两个反应，对不对？一个是信，一个是不信的，是不是？一个信，一个是不信。那信的也信的人呢，还要再做一件事情，就是受洗。受洗，信而受洗的必然得救，不信的必被定罪，是不是？那可是在另外一个，这是马可福音，在马太福音就他讲的就更清楚，他说你们要往普天下传福音给万民听，使万民做什么？我的门徒。但是为什么要信而受洗啊？其实信而受洗的意思就是我要跟随耶稣做耶稣的门徒，要不然就不需要受洗吧，不需要受洗啊。受洗代表我要立志跟随我的主，以耶稣做我们的拉比，做我们的师父。所以这个是很特别的一件事，传福音不是要只是让他成为一个信徒，而是要成为一个跟随耶稣基督的门徒。那今天我就在想说，到底门徒是什么？我们几乎没有基督徒不知道，我们要做门徒。可是到底什么是门徒？到底什么是门徒？学习者，那学生也是学习者啊。那到底我们要学什么东西？到底做什么？那我在偶然的机会里面看见了一个影片，我想让你们看一下。我不知道今天有没有办法放出来哈，因为好像有一点点问题，没有关系，我们就试看看。那请你要你知道要你要写笔记哈，因为很快只有15分钟的时间， 它里面有几个很重要的点，你要抓住。今天，我们第一堂我们就要讲什么是叫做主的门徒，到底谁可以做主的门徒？好，好不好？那我们看一下。影像没有出来，
the kind of person who does the right thing. And I don't just mean the big things where right and wrong are obvious and easy, but I mean the small things, the subtle, unnoticed things, like helping my neighbor when she's shoveling a driveway, you know, what I do when no one's watching. Because it's so easy to let those small things slip away. And it's those endless choices that we make every day that shape us and the kinds of people that we are. But this has started to change for me recently because I've started to believe different things about myself. A friend of mine gave me insight into the story about Jesus and his disciples that I'd heard before, but it's just taken on whole new meaning. Jesus' disciples are in a boat and it's the middle of the night and they're trying to get across the
不是这个东西，是另外一种，好像那个，
这边 OK 是没有测试啊，没有测试影像啊，声音 OK， 没有测试影像。
这种不行，不是用这种，不是抛 DVD 的。另外有一种，另外一个，
轻一点就没有。啊。你先关掉
啊，
关掉，可以。
哦，这个，第二，对的，这个就可以，嗯，对，这个，嗯，然后你等一下，要 subtitle，
对
，subtitle 不是，
subtitle
那个 subtitle 要用中文的 Mandarin 才行，不然你出来就是只有中文，就英文，不是，你
选中文的，选。But this has started to change for me recently because I've started to believe different things about myself. A friend of mine gave me insight into the story about Jesus.
好，感谢主。好，弟兄姐妹，感谢主哈，终于出来。
Kind of person who does the right thing. And I don't just mean the big things where right and wrong are obvious and easy, but I mean the small things, the subtle, unnoticed things, like helping my neighbor when she's shoveling a driveway, you know, what I do when no one's watching. Because it's so easy to let those small things slip away. And It's those endless choices that we make every day that shape us and the kinds of people that we are. But this has started to change for me recently because I've started to believe different things about myself. A friend of mine gave me insight into the story about Jesus and his disciples that I'd heard before, but it's just taken on whole new meaning. Jesus' disciples are in a boat, and it's the middle of the night, and they're trying to get across the lake, and the wind is blowing, and it's getting choppy, and Jesus comes walking out to them on the water. Now they think he's a ghost. So they're like, Jesus, is it you? And he says, yes. And one of them, Peter, gets out of the boat and starts walking on the water towards Jesus. What is Peter thinking? And why does he believe that he can walk on water? Now, what I've come to realize is the story makes way more sense if you understand the background. Jesus is a Jewish rabbi with Jewish disciples living in a first century Jewish world. Now, Jesus grew up in a region called the Galilee, and the Jewish people in the Galilee believed that God had spoken to Moses, one of their great historical leaders, and had given him the first five books of the Bible. They called these first five books the Torah. Torah means like teaching or instructions or simply the way.
摩西五经就是Torah.
And so Torah was the center, the foundation of their lives, and it was the focus of their educational system. So most Jewish boys or girls around the age of six would go to school for the first time to learn the Torah. It'd probably be held in the local synagogue and be taught by a local Torah teacher who was a rabbi. This first level of education was called Beit Sefer and lasted until the kid was around 10 years old. In Beit Sefer, most kids would memorize the Torah and by the age of 10 have the Torah by heart, every word. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, memorized. Now, by the end of Beit Sefer, which would be around 10 years of age, most kids were no longer going to school. They were apprenticing, learning the family trade, learning the family business, learning how to manage a household. But the best of the best would keep going. They would continue their education into the next level, which was called Beit Talmud. In Beit Talmud, the best of the best who were still going on, the ones with the most natural ability, would memorize the rest of the Hebrew scriptures. Genesis through Malachi, memorize. Now, by the end of Beit Talmud, 14, 15, most kids are learning the family business, learning the family trade, apprenticing with their parents. But the best of the best of the best would continue on to the next level of education, which was called Beit Midrash. And they'd go to a rabbi and they'd apply to that rabbi to become one of that rabbi's disciples. Now, when we use the word disciple, we often mean student, but we generally mean somebody who knows what the teacher knows. But a disciple is something far deeper. A disciple just doesn't want to know what the rabbi knows. A disciple wants to be like the rabbi and wants to learn to do what the rabbi does. Now, rabbis differed in how they interpreted the Torah. They would take like a verse or a command, and one rabbi might say, well, this is what it means to follow this verse or to do this command of God. But another rabbi might say, no, I think it means something slightly different. And so different rabbis had different sets of interpretations about how they lived out and understood and interpreted the scriptures. Now, a rabbi's set of interpretations was called that rabbi's yoke. So when you went and applied to a rabbi to become one of that rabbi's disciples, what you wanted to do is you wanted to take that rabbi's yoke upon you so that you could learn to know what the rabbi knows in order to do what the rabbi does in order to be like the rabbi. So you'd go to a rabbi and you'd say, Rabbi, I want to become one of your disciples. The rabbi would then grill you. The rabbi would ask you questions about Torah, questions about the prophets, questions about the oral tradition, because the rabbi wants to know, can this kid sit in front of me? Can this kid do what I do? Can this kid spread my yoke? Does this kid have what it takes? So the rabbi would fire off all these questions and grill the kid. And if the rabbi thought the kid, this kid's good, this kid loves God, loves Torah, but this kid isn't the best of the best of the best, the rabbi might say to the kid, you know, you obviously love God and you obviously know the Torah, but you don't have what it takes to become one of my disciples. And so the rabbi might say something like, go and continue learning your family trade. Continue plying your family trade. But if the rabbi thinks this kid has got it, I think this kid could do what I do. The rabbi would say to the kid, come, follow me. And so you would leave as this, 14, 15-year-old kid. You would leave your family, your friends, your synagogue, your village, and you would devote your entire life to being like your rabbi, learning to do what your rabbi does. This is what it means to be a disciple. Yours is much the same. Story again. So, a rabbi comes to town. A powerful rabbi. He's got like his little pack of disciples with him, and they're doing everything they can to keep up with him because they've devoted their lives to doing what their rabbi does. So if you're a disciple, by the end of the day with your rabbi traveling on these hot, dusty, dirty roads, you've got whatever your rabbi stepped in just caked all over the front of you. And so this saying developed among the wise men and the sages that you would say to a disciple, you'd say, may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi. This is a scene that everybody had seen this. They knew exactly what it meant to be covered in the dust of your rabbi. Now, all of this, to me, has huge implications for Jesus and how we understand Jesus, because most rabbis would begin their teaching around the age of 30. And in the Bible, around the age of 30, we have Jesus walking down the shore along the Sea of Galilee, and he comes across Peter and Andrew, and they're fishermen. And Jesus says to them, come, follow me. Well, if they're fishermen, and Jesus calls them to be his disciples, then they're not following another rabbi. And if they're not following another rabbi, they're not the best of the best. They didn't make the cut. And the text continues. It says that at once they dropped their nets and followed him, which I've always thought is a bit strange. I mean, it's odd, isn't it? That they just drop them and go. And I don't. Some of those Christian movies don't help, do they? I mean, it's like Jesus comes down the beach and he's in this white bathrobe and he has this light blue beauty pageant sash on, you know, and his hair is blow dried and he's Swedish, and he calls the disciples and they're kind of these robots. They kind of come around and go after him. If you understand it, like in its original context, it starts to make perfect sense. I mean, rabbis were the most honored, respected, revered people anywhere. I mean, the best of the best of the best are the only ones who got to be rabbis. And this rabbi comes down the beach and says to you, come follow me. Well, what's he really saying? What he's really saying is, I think you could do what I do. I mean, he's saying you can be like me. Of course you drop your nets and follow him. And then the text even continues. It says that he comes across James and John, and they're fishing with their father Zebedee. Now, if they're fishing with their father, what are they? They're apprentices. They're learning the family business. And if he calls them to be his disciples, then they're not the disciples of some other rabbi. So James and John, they're not good enough. They didn't make the cut either. They aren't the best of the best. And how old are they? 15? 16? I mean, 20? I mean, these are not old men. They're young. I mean, Jesus chooses them because his movement is for everybody. I mean, it's for rich and for poor and for women and men and educated and uneducated. I mean, actually, what's one of the things they say about them later on? One of the things they say about them later on is, these guys are like unschooled fishermen. I mean, it's for the peasants and the scholars. It's like a movement of anybody's, and he calls them the JV, the B team, the not good enoughs. He calls them to be his disciples, and they change the course of human history. Lost your faith. back to the walking on water thing. I mean, you have this boat full of anybodies, and the water's choppy, and the wind's blowing, and they're terrified because this Jesus comes across the water to them, and they think he's a ghost. And then Peter says, well, if it's you, then tell me to come to you. Now, why is this Peter's first response? Why is Peter's first reaction, if it's you, then tell me to come to you? Because he's a disciple. I mean, he's oriented his whole life, devoted his whole life to doing what he sees his rabbi doing, learning to be like his rabbi. So he sees his rabbi walking on water, and what's the first thing he wants to do? I want to walk on water too. I want to be like my rabbi. And so Peter gets out of the boat, and he starts walking on the water, but he starts to sink, and he yells out, Jesus, save me. And the text reads that Jesus immediately caught him and said, you of little faith, why did you doubt? Now, I always assumed that Peter doubts Jesus, but Jesus isn't sinking. Who does Peter doubt? He doubts himself. He loses faith in himself that he can actually be like his rabbi. I mean, Jesus wouldn't have called him if he didn't think he could be like him. Jesus even reminds his disciples of this at one point. He says to them, wait, you didn't choose me, I chose you. The rabbi doesn't choose you unless the rabbi thinks that you can do what he does, that you can be like him. I mean, all my life I've heard people talk about believing in God. But God believes in us, in you. In me. I mean, faith in Jesus is important, but what about Jesus' faith in us? I mean, he must have faith in us because he leaves it all in the hands of these disciples. And what's the last thing Jesus says to them? He says to them, now you go and make more disciples. He leaves it all in the hands of these anybodies, and they do it. I mean, what if we can actually be the kinds of people that God created us to be? What if he actually believes that? I mean, what if he actually believes that we can be the kind of people who live like Jesus lived? And the kinds of people who take action because we're aware of all of these endless opportunities around us all the time for good, for beauty, for truth. I mean, Jesus has faith that you can follow him and you can be like him. He believes it. May you believe in God, but may you come to see that God believes in you. May you have faith in Jesus, but may you come to see that Jesus has faith that you can be like him, a person of love and compassion and truth, a person of forgiveness and peace and grace and joy and hope, and may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi, Jesus.
那个布，那个他说要你要跟随你的拉比啊，你就是 cover 那他的 dust， 就是说他们走过去不是有一个脚印吗？你知道他们怎么走呢？他们就是走老师走的脚印，这叫 cover 那个 dust， 就是好，我昨天又看了四遍，我觉得很有意思。他解释了一个很重要的事情，就是耶稣呼召他们，他们就丢下一切。那我们就想说，哦，因为耶稣很有吸引力嘛，对不对？是不是？我们大家的解释就是这样子吧？因为耶稣很有吸引力，所以耶稣一句话出来，当然。他说其实背后是有原因的，好不好？我想因为我们没有很多时间了， 你们一定要自己要有被动的学习哈，效果是很不好的。你一定要是主动的学习，所以我们的课程哈，现在我们开始进入的这个课程，就是今天是第一课，你要开始学会，你要主动的去学习。我很想要知道，牧师给我的这个影片，他到底告诉我什么东西，好吗？那请你跟你旁边的人，好不好？那弟兄们，好不好？你们大概就是两个人，最多三个人在一起，就分享一下你刚才听见什么，看见什么，你就会发现每一个人的注意的点就是不太一样，哈，好不好？我们你不要单独哈，不要单独嘛。两个或是两个最多三个。这就是说，这个人不但要信耶稣，而且他开始要学习什么，跟随耶稣。那很有一个问题就是，可是现在耶稣在哪里？耶稣在天上，是不是？所以神就把这个权柄交给谁呢？交给使徒，就当时的使徒。所以使徒就成为当时代表耶稣的。所以当时信耶稣的人是跟随谁呢？就跟随第一代的使徒。那当然使徒第一代的使徒就过去，后来有新的使徒起来，就是像保罗像这个后来的提摩太、希拉，他们后来就变成第二代的使徒。那当然教会的历史还有一些那时候不叫做使徒，他们就叫教父。就教父教父。那所以我的意思是说，就是这样代代相传，那直到今天。那弟兄姐妹，今天教会主任牧师就是代表耶稣在地上，所以主任牧师，但是我很难带每一个人，对不对？我们教会那么多人，所以我们就透过我们的小组的系统，就拣选有一些人就成为小组长，那他就来代表牧师呢，来牧养他。那牧师做什么？牧师就牧养这些小组长，然后有一些小组长，他因为他带的他慢慢分职，他就变成区长。这一个小组长，你一辈子，你做小组长的过程里面，你一定要至少带两个人信耶稣，你至少要带一个人从牧道友变成就是进入我们的培育系统，一直到门徒班结业，这样你的这个职能才算。你作为一个区长，你至少要带四个人信耶稣。这个人是你需要去带领，你需要去传福音。你至少要带四个人成为基督徒，你至少要带两个人从牧道友变成进入我们的培育系统，一直到门徒班结业。那我的意思是说，每一个人都是这样子，去做很真实的去带门徒。每一个人都需要这样被带。你被带领过，你就知道去怎么样去带领别人。每一个人都是这样走的，这样走一定有所跟随的。那你知道教会有一种人呢，是直达天冲的，他都是神告诉他什么，神告诉他什么。其实他不是跟随神，他跟随谁呢？他跟随他自己。这是这种人，这是最简单的嘛。他认为这个就是神的带领，那他就这样就走。那他永远学不到顺服的功课，所以弟兄姐妹绝对不是这样子的。绝对不是这样子的。好，我们看见初代的教会也是，每一个人都是有跟随，有跟随的人才叫在 undercover 底下。所以当你们进入我不忘记了，这个活在遮盖下，不知道是哪一个，哪一个是什么班啊？活在啊？领袖班的哈，领袖班的最后成为领袖的，他们一定要知道叫安德在这个遮盖的底下。 所以弟兄姐妹，感谢神呢、啊。那这一篇影片让我很清楚的，让我们很清楚的知道什么叫做跟随者。跟随者不重点不在于学这个师父的这个师父这个拉比的知识，这个拉比最重要的是就是跟随他。做拉比所要做的事情，借着这个跟随，你去学会拉比他的品格，所以你看见，很重要的是，不是知识，不是知识，当然一定有知识的，因为你一天跟他在一起，你每一天都在跟他在一起，还有跟随是不是要付代价，是不是？是不是要付代价？所以没有可能，我反正我还是照我自己生活的方式啊。那你知道他们跟到一个地步，就是他老师在前面走哦，不是应该他们说拉比这个拉比在前面走，那他们跟着他，不是他这样走我就这样走，不是的，他是跟着老师的脚印。当然今天的路都是很干净，所以看不到脚印，但是在那一个时代。那个地上都是充满着尘土的，所以他们的脚落脚在什么地方，就落脚在门的他的师父的脚中的面。弟兄姐妹，感谢神，我从小我就一直是跟随者，我一直都是跟随者。我小时候我就跟我的哥哥，我有三个哥哥，我一直跟着我的上面的哥哥，就是第三个哥哥。小时候他就教我怎么样，所以他做什么我就做什么，所以我很小的时候我就跟着我的哥哥。那等到我到中学的时候，我为什么会很渴望认识耶稣？因为我看见我哥哥的改变啊，他是一个非常好的他的。各方面就是在我们家里面他就是一个非常非常棒的一个人。但是呢，当他信耶稣以后，我就觉得在他的生命里面有一个东西是非常吸引我的，所以我就很渴望。我知道他为什么会信，他为什么就是他去参加学生的这个夏令营、冬令营回来以后，他整个人就转变。所以这个只有在上了初中，那时候才叫初中啊，才能够去参加。所以我上了初中一年级的时候，我第一个寒假我就去参加那个校园团契办的国中的这个初中的营会。那弟兄姐妹，我在那一个营会里面，我也就得救以后，弟兄姐妹就开始进入校园团契，校园团契就有一些大哥哥大姐姐就带着我。所以弟兄姐妹，我一直的都一直的跟随。那我为什么会开始好好的读圣经？是因为带领我的团契的校园团就是我们学校团契的我们一个同工，他就告诉我说，他说你有没有把圣经读过一遍啊？我第一次有一个人问我说我圣经有没有读过一遍？其实我小学一年级就已经在教会你们。我说圣经这么厚，怎么可能读完？怎么可能读完？他说你只要一天一天读四章，一年就可以读完一遍。那我说我新约已经读了很多遍，但是我旧约我从来没有想过旧约可以读完，所以我就开始我在我高中毕业的时候。毕业之前我就下定决心，在高中毕业之前我一定要把旧约读完一遍。那弟兄姐妹，感谢神，就从那个时候开始就是主神就一直的带着，一直的有人在带领我。所以你知道我去当兵的时候，我身上带着一本很小的新约圣经，那个小就是这么大概就这么大，就可以放在口袋里面。那本圣经呢，在我的口袋里面，我只要有时间我就拿出来读圣经。那这本圣经呢，因为在抄课的时候就流汗了，所以那本圣经呢就湿了又干，干了又湿，就这样子。那一直 就是在新兵训练营，我就是这样子，每一天都这样子。那为什么会这样？因为我带领我的这个辅导啊，还有我的旁边的同工，我们都是接受一个很好的圣经的读圣经的老师，一直教我就一直成为一个读圣经的人。那我们那时候不是只有读圣经，还要背圣经。背圣经，一章一章，我背过的是以弗所书的第一章跟第二章，哦，那就是这个还有很多的他有规定要读背的地方。那我们的聚会，我们的我那时候在青少年的聚会，我们聚会没有很多很多很多的玩意，很多的安排什么东西，我们聚会唱完诗歌就是背圣经，你背，我们每一个人就这样背圣经。弟兄姐妹，我感谢神，圣经告诉我们说要丰丰富富的把神的话藏在你的心里，是不是？那弟兄姐妹，感谢神，我中学的时候就是这样走过来，所以神的话就充满在我的里面。我一直感谢神，一直带人。在中学的时候，我遇见一个叫做妙学里的一个宣教士，他也是充满了爱心的一个加拿大人，他就常常的来鼓励我们，带着我们。那真的我就是说一辈子，后来我当完兵回来，谁带着我呢？就是周神柱牧师，我是周牧师第一批的带领的门徒，那就他也是他帮助我，让我能够跨出一步，让我成为进入全职侍奉神的，也是因为周牧师的带领，所以一日为师啊，终身为父，所以我非常的尊敬周牧师。周牧师啊，本来这次我父亲过世了，那本来我们就想说，我们就家人，因为爸爸年纪很大，他自己的亲友几乎都不在了。对，他的那一代的几乎都没有人都没有人还活着的，所以我们就想说，我们家的家族呢，就说，可是周牧师说不行，他说周牧师说不行，他是林良堂第一个超过100岁过世的，所以就一定要来感谢上帝的恩典，所以他就告诉我们一定要满，那我们就听他的话，因为他是我们的师父。所以弟兄姐妹，一日为师，终身为父。那弟兄姐妹，我充满了感恩的心。那在这一段这一个影片里面，他有讲到几个很重要的一个东西，就是说我们作为门徒，是师父选我们的，还是我们是选师父？所以弟兄姐妹，我不知道你是不是一个挺觉聪明的人，我不知道你在学校里面你的成绩是不是很好，如果是的话，那你真的是得天独厚。那我告诉你，我不是，我可能是三流的四流的，真的。我到美国去的时候，我们那个大概有40几个，都是全时间我们在学习要侍奉神，里面有好几个博士，有很多硕士，有很多台大毕业的，然后他们就去到美国去留学，后来呢他们就被主呼召。那我们这个哇，看他们那时候，我们的读圣经的工具没有像现在这么方便，现在电脑上去就行了，可是以前不行了。以前我们要查信心，我们就要把那个用 concordance 去那 concordance 呢，就会把关于信心这个所有的词都列出来在圣经的某一个地方。可是呢，你需要把它只有讲在出证比如说马太福音这个3:5有这个字那它，但是你如果要读这个词，你就必须要把它抄下来。我们是很辛苦抄，哇！为了要读这个词，我们必须要 这个所有的人一起来，哦，你抄马创世纪，我抄启示录，啊，哦，他抄哪里跟哪里，啊，那每一个人就这样努力的抄。那弟兄姐妹，真的，我看见聪明的人真的是很聪明，哇，他们很会读书，所以他们读圣经呢，他们有哦，他们真是有一套。但弟兄姐妹，感谢神呢，耶稣说不是你们拣选我，是我拣选你们。如果是拉比来选，我想他们要选的都是顶绝聪明的人，对不对？如果我是拉比，我也要选比较聪明的嘛，比较好教嘛，哦，那还有真的这些人他们肯付，因为他们要做学生呢，他们就必须做一件事情，舍去一切到老师的家里面跟老师一起住。那你以为去老师家里就每一天开始上课？不是的，就是看老师怎么生活，然后看老师叫你做什么。其实老师所有的杂事都是谁做的呢？就是这些门徒做的。那你会说，我是要来学你的，你怎么让我去做这些好像没有什么意义的事情呢？他一开始就讲，是不是一开始他讲，就是他看见，就是他用一个残血的背景，你说这残血有什么有什么不得了的事情呢？但是他说，他以前他也以为这些都是小事，这些都不会发生，不会对你有什么影响。后来他开始改变了，他就发现，其实在很小的事情上，就开始看见我们这个人的状况。耶稣是不是说，在小事上忠心，在大事上就忠心，在小事上不义，在大事上就不义，是不是？所以弟兄姐妹，感谢神。上个礼拜我讲，我们怎么跟随耶稣，在教会里面就是一个最好的机会，学习在小组里面学习顺服你的小组长。在教会里面，你找到机会就去服事。服事不需要，当然有很多事情是需要安排的，但是其实不是你没有安排了你就没有事情。因为前面我是主任牧师，可是我常常都有额外的事情要做。比如说你们等一下走了，这个椅子马上就变成什么，啊，就开始歪了，对不对？所以弟兄姐妹，你知道很不容易，是不是？每一个人坐椅子 的习惯不一样，所以椅子就开始凌乱。那要做什么？就要把它排起来。我并没有被安排今天要排椅子，可是我看见椅子不平的时候， 不整齐的时候，我就做什么？我就去拍一次。我到厕所里面去，我常常擦地，你知道，因为有些人上厕所的习惯是比较，我们没有办法要求每一个人一定要怎样，对不对？但是如果脏了怎么办？教会并没有安排我负责 整理这个厕所，是不是？可是当我看见厕所有脏的时候，我就去。我不是只有教会，有一次我在飞机上，那飞机到了快要过了三分之二的路程的时候，每一个人都很疲倦的，那厕所就脏得不得了。我一次进去也是到处都是纸，圣灵就告诉我，把它整理干净，让下一个人进来的时候不会像你一样的感觉。弟兄姐妹，我就去把它整理干净。 所以弟兄姐妹，你知道，这是我从教会里面学到的。所以我出去的时候，我就很自然的，我就会可以做。弟兄姐妹，其实，在每一件事情上，就是在学习啊。注意人的需要，注意环境里面的需要，就去做。亲爱的弟兄姐妹，感谢主，就是跟随耶稣基督，跟随耶稣基督做卑微的事情，从卑微的事情开始来学习。这样有一天，当神提拔你起来的时候，你就不会骄傲，你就会很安全，你就不会充满了你的自我。弟兄姐妹，你知道我们很好面子，是不是？我们很希望被别人尊崇。但弟兄姐妹，耶稣在地上的时候有没有很被人尊崇？保罗有没有？没有。所以弟兄姐妹，所以如果你很想要在教会里面被人家都很尊崇你，弟兄姐妹，你可能走错了地方，因为在这里就是学习怎样服侍人。耶稣说，当门徒在那边彼此争论谁为大的时候，耶稣告诉他们说什么？他说在外面是，可是在教会呢？他说不是的，在教会要怎样？你们愿意为大的就要做什么？众人的什么？用人。耶稣真的是用说用人呢，就是做众人的用人。哇，弟兄姐妹，这一篇太重要。他最后他讲到，这些被呼召的人，其实都不是 best， 对不对？不是 best 当中的 best 的 best， 是不是？都是被淘汰的，他们都不可能有机会。所以当耶稣来呼召他们的时候，哇，他们为什么会丢掉一切？终于有人认为我可以，这个拉比为这个拉比为什么会呼召这个学生呢？因为他认为这个学生可以。那他们为什么会被所有的拉比去弃绝呢？因为没有一个人认为他们可以。可是忽然间有一个人来到他面前，说：“我相信你可以，来跟从我。”他就立刻丢下一切，对不对？这就很合理的啊，是不是？弟兄姐妹，这不是很神奇的事，这是很合理的事情。我有现在在啊、在以前在瑞安街聚会，有一个叫伊利凡。他40岁的时候，神呼召他出来。他是一个胶带工厂的厂长。当神呼召他的时候，他就出来。他自己做见证，他说：“我是厂长。”他说：“我招工的时候，40岁的人啊，他说我一定不要用了。不管他是什么多伟大的人，他说我都不会用，因为40岁已经。”没有希望，没有办法栽培了。他说啊，现在我40岁，上帝还要用我。所以他说，我觉得是上帝太看重我，所以他就把厂长的工作丢掉，他就出来侍奉神。现在他已经70几岁。弟兄姐妹，感谢神。所以不管你现在几岁，耶稣说来跟从我。他说我们都很期待，我们都希望我们是可以相信神。他说你知不知道，神相信你可以做他所能做的事情，你能够成为他的门徒。弟兄姐妹，我们一起祷告。天父，谢谢你，当我们在这里来到你的面前， 谢谢耶稣，借着这一个短短的 DVD， 主啊，提醒我们很多的事情，主啊，让我们放在我们的心里面，也恩膏在我们的中间，让我们每一个人都知道，今天我们没有什么可夸的，但是另外一方面，我们要看见主啊，你拣选软弱的人，叫刚强的人羞愧；你拣选愚拙的人，叫有智慧的人羞愧。主啊，谢谢你，你没有放弃。当世人放弃我们，当那个有权柄的人，当那些有智慧的人、有能力的人放弃我们的时候，主啊，感谢你，你带来这个世界的一个非常大的革命。主啊，你使用那些愿意的人，谢谢主，你祝福我们，与我们同在。谢谢主，你让我们走在你自己的道路里面，跟随你。主啊，做你的门徒。谢谢你听我们的祷告，奉耶稣基督的名，阿门。